Well, good morning, everybody. So good to be with you this morning. Hope everybody's having a wonderful morning and have had a great time of worshiping the Lord this morning so far. You know, before we open up God's Word, we are going to be just in the book of Genesis where we started last week. This week will be in Genesis chapter 39. So if you don't have a Bible, I would encourage you to grab one from one of the chairs in front of you. Just look below the rack there. Should have one. Sometimes they get pushed to the back and you can't see they're there. And if you're not sure where Genesis is, it's the first book of the Old Testament, and just find chapter 39 at that point. A couple of things, though, before we dive into our text this morning, I want to just kind of make sure that we pray about. I know probably on all of our hearts and minds is we got a big week in front of us, right? It's the elections coming, and I think we should just pause just to pray. And I want to just remind us, I think it's so important always for us to remember who sits on the throne. Right? He is high and lifted up. He is exalted. He is the one who is there. We have Jesus who sits at the right hand of the Father, that there is the one and only true God who is in control of all things, always has been, always will be. And I think we just pray, right, that the Lord's will be done, because it will be. And no matter what happens, God will accomplish his holy purposes. He always has, and he always will. Right? So I think we put our hearts at rest in that truth, right? That's where we need to anchor ourselves. And I want to encourage you that if things come up this week and you have conversations, try to direct it there. Try to bring people away from maybe discouragement and despair and anger and frustration or whatever else they might feel, and bring it back to the Lord. Bring it back to him. Let's do that. We want to pray for that. Also, just want to mention to you that, you know, we want to encourage you, as you've already seen early in the service, we do a portion here at our worship time, because it's part of worship, where we talk about giving. And I want to encourage you, just as we kind of make our way to the end of the year, oftentimes as you get closer to the end of the year, you're squaring up against church budgets and things, and you're kind of looking at where we're at as a church on that, and we're behind quite a bit, actually, as a church overall, when I say all of our campuses, all six of them. I want to just encourage you just to remember that and to pray, not only just to pray on behalf of the church that the Lord continues to provide, but also want to encourage you just if you're at a place in your own giving where sometimes we have to either be reminded, a little love nudge to say, hey, remember, giving is a part of worship. And I know having done this for a lot of years, I also know that there are certain times in life where it's really hard to give and things are really challenging. And I also want to just encourage you, sometimes you have to just step out and take a step of faith in your giving. And if you haven't had a practice of giving or a habit of giving, just to take a step in that direction, right? God doesn't expect perfection from any of us because we'll never be able to give it, but just take a step in that direction. So I want to encourage you to do that. The Lord will provide for his church. He always has. He always will. He will also provide for you. He'll take care of every one of your needs. One of the things you want to make sure is that we bring ourselves, all of ourselves, to God in worship. So let's pray together. Father, this morning, so grateful that we can be here. Thank you for your word, Lord. We thank you so much for your church. We thank you for all the churches that are gathered all over that are worshiping you, Lord Jesus, and preaching your word, and Lord, standing firm in the gospel. Lord, we think of this week that we're about to enter into, Lord. We know it's a big week for our country. And Lord, we just want to pray that there would be just, I guess, clear heads, Lord, would prevail. We know, Lord, that people get really sort of elevated emotionally, Lord, at times like this. Emotions run really hot. And Lord, we just would ask, Lord, that regardless of the outcome of this election, there's somebody that's not going to be happy, Lord, for sure. And we just want to pray, Lord Jesus, that you would help people to just be more measured in that. Lord, we as followers of Jesus, Lord, we love you. We thank you that you're on the throne. Thank you, Lord, that by faith we can go forward knowing, Lord, that whatever happens, you are our God. And that you're working things out, that you've always had a plan, Lord. But we just ask that you would help us to be a light to the people around us, to maybe even people that are other followers of Jesus, or even to those people in our community and around us, so people that we work with, Lord. Help us, Lord. Use us to be able to point them to Jesus, to point them to you, Lord. And Father, we just pray that, God, you would just really show yourself so powerful, Lord Jesus, in and through this time, that, Lord Jesus, we would trust you with the things of this world. Lord, things are not going to be orchestrated and fixed by us. They won't be. We have limited things that we can do, Lord, but we can vote. And once we've done that, Lord, we just hand that over to you. And we just surrender it, Lord. So, Father, we also just thank you for the church, and we pray, Lord, for the church's finances, Lord, that you would continue to strengthen and help us as we make our way towards the end of the year, Lord. We just pray that, Lord Jesus, you would bless abundantly, Lord, and encourage and strengthen, Lord, the church so that we can go forward and finish the year strong at a few months or a couple months away from that end point. Jesus, we thank you for your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. Well, there is this little thing that you encounter every once in a while when you look at a tombstone or a gravestone. It's this little dash. You know that little dash, the little thing that's there between two dates, right? The date of one's birth and the date of one's death. It's the little dash. And it represents, that little dash, doesn't it? It represents the totality of your life at that point. It's all summed up. Everything that happened in your 70, 80, 90, however many years of your existence you will have, everything is summed up right there in that dash. It's kind of something, and very sobering when you think about that. Of course, we know that there's so much more that goes on in a person's life than the dash, but that's what the dash represents, from birth to death. The question that I always think of when I think about that dash is I think about the legacy that we would leave behind. Because what is that dash to other people? And it's not only what we leave behind, but it's also how we choose to live our lives even today, because it really matters. And we think about this in terms of a life of integrity or a life of faithfulness, how all of that can be lived in such a way for years, but all of a sudden be just trashed in a moment. And the way people think about the dash, the way they think about you is different. You know, there are so many epic fails over the past number of years by high-profile people, right? And there are epic fails that happen all the time, but it's the high-profile people, of course, that we get to see all over the place and hear all about. How are those individuals remembered? Even the ones who have had epic failures and they're still here, they're still alive, but we remember them oftentimes in such a way where now they have lost all integrity. They have lost all sort of credibility with an individual or with a group of individuals. Now, please don't get me wrong when I speak of this, that the Lord, with the Lord, there's always forgiveness. Isn't there? There's always mercy. I mean, we can fall too. We can have epic failures in our lives. He gives, no doubt, great mercy and grace to even the worst of sinners when they confess and they repent of their sin, and yet we all know that still there's the remaining effects of sin and the way people think about other people. When you think about biography, that's kind of what a biography does, right? Oftentimes biographies, though, they kind of clean up the character, make the character look maybe a little more rosy than they were. I've been to a lot of funerals over the years with people not from the Christian faith, but from when I lived in my time in Utah. And it was always interesting to me because some of the individuals that would be eulogized, you know that they didn't actually live that way at all. But for some reason, all of a sudden, at the time of their death, they're like Mother Teresa kind of saint level, and they're not. Biographies of individuals. No one's lives are perfect, right? And a good biography is going to sort of bring that out and show that there's imperfections, especially amongst followers of Jesus. We see that in a person's biography if you get a chance to read it. But overall, when you look at read a good biography or you look at an individual's life, you see overall the message of a person's life that dominates. And it just makes you think, when you read a good biography, you think, what about me? What will they say of me? What are they saying about me right now? What would be the characteristic that might dominate or drive sort of the one word that might come to their mind when they think about you? Years ago, some of you will remember this song. Years ago, Steve Green wrote a song called Find Us Faithful. It goes like this: we're pilgrims on the journey on the narrow road. Those who've gone before us line the weary, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary. Their lives a stirring testament to God's sustaining grace. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race, not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly lives. Now, that's a great thing to know, to be known for, isn't it? The dash in a person's life to be known at the end of their life, but also throughout their life, to be known as an individual that's an individual that is faithful. A faithful man or a faithful woman of God. Well, last week we began a new series on the character of Joseph from the Old Testament in the book of Genesis, chapters 37 through 50, where God gave us 13 chapters that describe in interesting detail that his life was one that is marked by faithfulness. It's a biography, if you will, when you read it. It's a shorter biography. It's 13 chapters. It doesn't tell you everything about the life of Joseph, but it tells you some very interesting pieces. And our text this morning that we're in Genesis 39, I think really brings out for us this particular aspect of his character, the aspect of the faithfulness of Joseph. This morning we're going to look at just two things, and the first thing we're going to look at has to do with the faithfulness of Joseph, and secondly, we're going to look at the faithfulness of God. But I want to begin, and we're going to walk through this passage in Genesis chapter 39, and I want us to begin then, first of all, by looking at the faithfulness of Joseph in this text. Our text tells us three truths about the faithfulness of Joseph. And so if you have your Bibles and you're turned there to Genesis chapter 39, I want you to notice, first of all, in verses 1 through 6, that he was faithful when displaced. He was faithful when he was displaced. Three things to note about him. Number one, he's faithful when he was displaced. In Genesis 39, we pick up the account from last week, and we read that Joseph had been brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, the captain of the guard, an Egyptian, had bought him from the Ishmaelites who brought him down there. The Lord was with Joseph, and he became a successful man, and he was in the house of the Egyptian master. His master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord caused all that he did to succeed in his hands. So Joseph found favor in his sight and attended him, and he made him overseer of his house and put him in charge of all that he had. From the time that he made him overseer in his house and over all that he had, the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. The blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in house and field. So he left all that he had in Joseph's charge, and because of him, he had no concerns about anything but the food that he ate. This text, I think, describes the faithfulness of Joseph and showing that actually how he's such a faithful individual, even though he's been displaced. Now, remember where he's come from. If we just take Genesis chapter 39 and we cut off chapter 37, we will recognize that that would be a real big error because we would miss out on the whole backstory of how he got to this point. He is certainly displaced, we know, in this text. He comes to chapter 39, but he comes having left his father's house. He's now, against his will, in the house of Potiphar. He was once in his father's house, but his brothers, if you remember in chapter 37, treated him so poorly that they threw him into a pit. They sold him to traders. That brought him to Egypt. He was bought by Potiphar, and he became now a household slave in Potiphar's house. When that kind of stuff goes on in a person's life, it's really easy, actually, to be tempted to not be faithful because your whole life has been disrupted. I mean, imagine for Joseph how he would feel. He's not going to see his father for years and years. His father thinks that he's dead. His brothers have just spewed out great hatred towards him. And now he's in a foreign land, and he's not only in a foreign land, but he's actually now in slavery in this house. And yet in the midst of that, Joseph's character remains faithful throughout all of this. In the midst of being displaced. You know, I guess you could say in a sense that Joseph, roll with the punches sounds to be too easy. But here he is, he's displaced, he's sold into slavery. And he probably viewed this as, I'm going to grow where I'm planted kind of an idea. I'm here, God has me here, I don't know why God has me here. Remember, Joseph at this point doesn't know what's going on. All he's had in chapter 37 is some dream that his brothers interpreted as that you're going to rule and reign over us based upon the dream that you're telling us. But Joseph has no idea when that's going to happen, how that's going to happen. There's no indication in the text that that's even the accurate interpretation of the dream. And here he is now all of a sudden thrown into a pit, traded by his brothers, taken to Egypt, put into slavery in a house that he is now managing as the household slave. But somewhere along the way, Joseph must have decided that he would still grow where he's planted. That he wouldn't allow all of that sort of, all that displacement to allow him to completely fall apart. And it kind of makes you wonder in your own life, doesn't it? What would I do if I was facing such things like that? Would I at that point fall apart if my world falls apart? If things start not making sense to me, what do I do? How do I respond? But Joseph here, even though he doesn't know what God is doing at this point, still remains faithful. And he's actually faithful to the work that he's been entrusted with, hasn't he? In this text, he's Potiphar's slave, and he actually takes it seriously. He takes it so seriously that great favor comes upon him, and God blesses the work of his hands and blesses Potiphar's household as a result of it as well. But I want you to also notice in our text as we continue that not only was he faithful when displaced, I want you to notice that he was also faithful when tempted. He was faithful when he was tempted in verses 7 through 12. Starting at the end of verse 6, in fact, we read these words, "Now Joseph was handsome in form and appearance. And after time, his master's wife cast her eyes on Joseph and said, 'Lie with me.' But he refused and said to his master's wife, 'Behold, because of me, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put everything that he has in my charge. He is not greater in this house than I am, nor has he kept back anything from me except you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?' And as she spoke to Joseph day after day, he would not listen to her, to lie beside her or to be with her. But one day when he went into the house to do his work, and none of the men of the house were there in the house, she caught him by the garment, saying, 'Lie with me.' But he left the garment in her hand and fled and got out of the house." You see, Joseph is in this pretty difficult situation where he's been displaced, certainly sold into slavery. And now we're told in this text that he's also faithful, though, in the midst of severe temptation. Joseph's situation is actually quite different than a lot of the temptation that others experience, in that he's a slave. He can't really do anything about this. Not without probably being killed as a slave. You know, when you and I face temptation, we can usually make a decision to extricate ourselves from the situation lest we be tempted any further, or we make a decision to stay in the situation and succumb and yield to the temptation, to move closer to it. That's usually the reality for most of us when we face temptation. Joseph's situation is he's stuck. I mean, this is what he's been bought. He's a slave. He is in this house, and there's nothing he can do about it other than if he wants to walk and actually probably be executed as a slave. So here he is, not just once being tempted, but repeatedly being tempted and enticed by Potiphar's wife. I think the number one problem that Joseph had is probably the end of verse 6. He was handsome in form and appearance. Poor guy. There's something to be said for not being handsome in form and appearance. He caught the eye of Potiphar's wife because of his looks. Sometimes with my daughters growing up, I always sometimes think, just, Lord, help them to be very homely. for years and years and years so that nobody would show any interest in them. But that didn't happen, so. But notice it's after a time, we're told in the text, his master's wife cast her eye on Joseph and said, "Lie with me." So this is when, it's not as soon as he gets into the house. After time, she must have been watching and observing him. And over a period of time, she's like, "I kind of like this guy." Now remember, Joseph, when we're introduced to him in chapter 37, he's 17 years of age. And we don't exactly know when the whole move to Egypt happened. It was probably, I assume, right around 17 years of age. And he's sold into slavery. He's a young man. And we don't know how long, this text doesn't tell us how long he's in Potiphar's house before this actually starts happening. But he is a young man, handsome in form and appearance, and she sees him. Now you might wonder at this point, why have you guys jumped in your preaching in all our campuses? We've skipped over Genesis chapter 38. Have you noticed that? We went from 37 to all of a sudden 39. It kind of reminds you of like when you get a kid's Bible and you're like, wait a second, like there's vast sections of the Bible removed out of here. Well, it's because there's sections of the Bible that you don't want to tell your kids quite yet, right? Like, you know, have you ever tried to explain circumcision to your kids? Like, that's a little bit challenging, right? Or you know, you talk to them about certain stories in the Bible where there's rape that's happened or things like that in text. There's certain sort of age-appropriate subjects, right? We didn't skip over this because of the inappropriateness of the account, but no doubt there's some seriously inappropriate things that happen in Genesis chapter 38 as there are here in 39. We skipped over it actually for a reason. It's not actually skipped over, it's to tie it in. Why is it that in Genesis chapter 38, why is this story about Judah put right beside the story about Joseph? They're very similar stories. In fact, in your community groups, as you gather, you can think about the connection between the two and why this is happening. For example, if you were just to take your Bible and go to the end of chapter 37, verse 36, I believe it is, the very last verse, and then just ignore chapter 38 for a second and just read the beginning of chapter 39, verse 1, the two are like bookends almost in a sense, right? They tell the sort of same thing. You end in chapter 37 that he's into Egypt, that he's sold into slavery. In 39, it begins he's sold into slavery to Potiphar. Well, why 38 then? What's the point of that? I mean, this is the story or the account of Joseph, is it not? Starting in 37, why is there a whole chapter devoted to Judah? It's simply, I think, for this reason, to give you and I a stark contrast between the righteousness and the faithfulness of Joseph and the unfaithfulness and wickedness of Judah. In chapter 38, if we were to go back over that text, you find that Judah has a couple of kids, and they get married, and his kids are wicked kids. And yet, the first kid who's married to this particular woman, he dies. The Lord puts him to death because of his wickedness. So in keeping with customs, they would give the wife to the next son in line. So Judah's next son would have his brother's wife. He refused to sort of follow through on having a child with her, and so the Lord sees his wickedness. He puts him to death as well. Meanwhile, Judah's wife dies, the text tells us. And he's in mourning, and after he's comforted, you find him doing something. You find him wandering off and finding a prostitute. That prostitute happens to be his son's wife, who went in disguise as a prostitute because she knew that for her to carry on the family name, she was going to have relations with somebody. So she deceived and tricked Judah, and she ended up having relations with him. Judah, of course, is oblivious to this. He just thinks that it's a temple prostitute from back in the day. But you see, that story is so contrasted because what's underscored in chapter 38 is the wickedness of Judah's two sons. They're both called wicked. When Judah gets finally found out from Tamar, when she finally says to them, "Listen, that was me," he makes this comment to her. He says that you are more righteous than I. You see, Judah's wicked. And now all of a sudden you begin chapter 39 and you have the story of Joseph. Different set of circumstances, but a similar kind of an idea in terms of here is Joseph with this opportunity to fall in a massive way on his face. Out of Judah, what may be his loss of his wife, he decides to go in a direction towards another woman. Joseph, in the midst of being displaced and facing this severe temptation, doesn't respond that way. In fact, his response is one of incredible faithfulness. And I want to give you three things I think that he does. First of all, in verses 7 through 9, he refuses. That's all he does. He just refuses. If you read the text with me again, notice, "And after a time, his master's wife cast her eyes on Joseph and said, 'Lie with me,' but he refused and said to his master's wife, 'Behold, because of me, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put me in charge of everything. He is not greater in this house than I am, nor has he kept back anything from me except you, because you are his wife. How can I do this great wickedness?'" Notice again the contrast of the wickedness of Judah in chapter 38. "How can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" Joseph in this text understands that to yield to her repeated solicitations is to sin, if you will, against Potiphar himself, the master of the house who has entrusted him with the management of the entire house, but has been clear that his wife is off limits. He sees that. He gets that. He understands that. He doesn't take advantage of the opportunity, even though it's presented right in front of him over and over and over again by her. But he also, in verse 9, notice, understands so clearly, in contrast to Judah, that to yield to her repeated solicitations is to sin against God. Again, in verse 9, notice he says, "How then could I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" Judah doesn't ask that question at all. I think there's something in this story, in both accounts, that I think to draw out just for a moment. When are we tempted? You know, like sometimes I find like, so when it comes to food for me, I'm a snacker, right? And I have to really work hard to not snack late at night. And I found over the years, I realized that I'm a stress eater actually. Right? So when I'm under stress, I don't necessarily think to myself, I'm under stress, therefore let's go eat some nachos. But that's what I'll do. Why am I doing that? It's because I'm trying to sort of assuage my stress, the anxiety that I'm feeling, and I'm trying to bring comfort into my life in some shape or form, right? Now, people do that with all kinds of things. It could be food. It could be sort of drugs. It could be sexual things. I mean, it could be anything under the sun that one would do that to, that they turn to in order to sort of help them to alleviate those kind of things. I think in the story of Judah, if you look at it, remember, Judah's wife and his kids have died. But what does he do? He turns to a prostitute. You know, when we're really up against it, we're really susceptible to temptation, aren't we? When we're really weak, when we're really down, we're really open, we're really prone to fall. Joseph, however, is held up as an example of, he's up against it. I mean, his back's against the wall. There's no doubt about it. Think of all that he has gone through in just chapter 37 and now in this chapter. But there's something about Joseph where he's like, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. I mean, the amount of justification that one could bring to the table if you were Joseph. The amount of reasoning that you could have. But he doesn't do it. Sometimes I want to think, well, maybe he wasn't attracted to the woman at all. Maybe she was like, oh, you know what? Like off of Jerry Seinfeld, she looks really good in the dark, but she comes in the light and she's like, ah, You know, those of you who watch Seinfeld, you know. Maybe it was one of those things, but you don't get that sense from here. You just, she's probably an older woman than him. You know, I think we call them cougars today. Right? I mean, she's going after him. But he stands firm. So he refuses to do this. And notice the second thing in verse 10 is that he resists her, right? He resists her. And after she spoke to Joseph, day after day, he would not listen to her, to lie beside her, or to be with her. Day after day. And you read this text, and if you spend time with this, you start thinking to yourself, man, how long did this go on for? Day after day. Well, I can tell you this. I can tell you that the Jews, back in what we call the Second Temple period, okay, this is between 250 BC and roughly before the time of Christ, they wrote a bunch of stuff. And some of you have been in things that I've done where I've talked about this group of material. This is a collection of writings known as the pseudepigrapha. It's a collection of writings, and in those writings, they have a group of writings called the Testament of the Twelve. They're not scripture, they're just Jewish sort of reinterpretation, if you want, or interpretation of the Bible. And in these testaments, they're the last will and testaments of the patriarchs, the 12 patriarchs. And it's their deathbed saying, basically cleaning up their character and cleaning up their life. So you have a testament for Judah where he cleans up his life at the end before he dies. And this is the Jewish way back in that time of trying to go, okay, what do we do with our characters? Let's clean up their acts. Well, you have one of Joseph as well. And in fact, you have the testament of the 12 patriarchs and Joseph and the account of Potiphar. Again, this is not scripture at all, but I do think it's interesting in this. They're kind of like writing novels almost back then. It's kind of like if you ever read a Francine Rivers novel or something, which I've never have, but my wife has read lots. They sort of read between the lines a lot, right? Or if for some reason you like The Chosen, but don't get me going on that. If you like The Chosen series, there's a lot of reading in between the lines that happens, right? In terms of filling in all kinds of unknown things and details. This is what it's like with the Testament of the Twelve. You have this Joseph account, and when you read the account, if you just read 39, you're kind of left there going, man, I wonder like about this, and I wonder about this, and I wonder about this. Any texts that are like this is prime material for Jewish interpreters back in the day to sort of fill in the gaps, to explain it, to speculate. So I can tell you, for example, that the Testament, particularly about Judah, tells us that it was a seven-year period of solicitation that he endured, and tells us that she had no kids. She tried a number of things, actually, to get him to yield to her sexually. She pretended to merely visit him one time, as if she just wanted to see him, and she had no kids of her own, so she kind of pretended to be more like a mother to him, considered to him be more like a son, but sort of setting up in such a way so that she could actually have relations with him. That's the one thing. The second thing is that the story tells you that she promised that he would get promoted if he would just sleep with her. I mean, after all, she knows Potiphar. She could make sure that he gets in the right career pathway. She would give up her many gods, she told him at one point, if she'd follow Joseph's gods, if he would just sleep with her. You see the solicitations as they come, right? You can kind of see and imagine this maybe happening. Again, these aren't real things. They're just somebody speculating. You can see, for example, she also says that she would actually get rid of her husband. She would off him. She would kill him. She tries to bribe him with gifts on another occasion. She tries to drug him. And that she even gets to the point where she says she's going to end her own life if she can't have him. I mean, talk about a predator. Now, none of that is actually real, right? It didn't actually happen that way. But when you read the text, you wonder, what all unfolded? That he's repeatedly, day after day, dealing with this solicitation. And day after day, he has to stand firm. And day after day, he's having to say, how can I sin against God? How can I do this wickedness? And he wouldn't. Until finally, it got to the point where he had to run. He had to run. You know, you and I, the advice would be run first, right? Like, Resist, sure, refuse, but it's like all a simultaneous event, right? Resist, refuse, run. Like, just get out of there. Run from this temptation. Flee as fast as you can from it. Joseph didn't have the luxury, but the long-term resisting, right, refusing, but he finally got to the point in verses 11, 13 where he has to actually say, I got to get out of here. In verse 11, one day when she went into the house to do his work, or when he went into the house to do his work, and none of the men of the house was there in the house, she caught him by his garment, saying, lie with me. But he left his garment in her hand and fled and got out of the house. That's what he did. And as soon as she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and fled the house, she called out to the men of her household. So Joseph finally flees. He flees from the scene. I think as we read this text, when we think about sort of our own faithfulness in our own lives, I mean, Joseph's situation here is one of sexual sin and sexual temptation, but the reality is there's all kinds of temptation under the sun that we go through as individuals that we can face. I'm often mindful, though, when I read texts like this of the book of Proverbs in chapter 4 through 7, which is this incredible account as you could turn there if you want to, but in Proverbs chapter 4 through 7, we read about the woman of adultery. And it's not to pick up simply on women who are the adulteresses, because men, as we all know, are predators for sure. But the text was written by Solomon, and Solomon has plenty of example also being a womanizer, if you know the story of Solomon, right? It's not a pretty one. I mean, the guy had a massive amount of wives and concubines, right? So did David. David is also a bit of a womanizer. You know, we like the cleaned up version of David, but David had lots of problems in his own life. He wasn't all that great at times. But he's still, for some reason, a man after God's own heart. But in Proverbs chapter 4, if you want to turn there, I want you to notice the advice that's actually given. And it's actually really similar to what Joseph does. In Proverbs chapter 4, verses 23, the advice is this: keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. In other words, guard your heart, right? Guard your heart with all diligence. From your heart comes the spring of life. Verse 25, let your eyes look directly forward and your gaze be straight before you. Ponder the path of your feet. Then all your ways will be sure. Do not swerve to the right or to the left. And now in chapter 5 and 6 and 7, he really weighs in on this issue of adultery. He says, my son, be attentive to my wisdom. The lips, in verse 3, of a forbidden woman drip honey, and her speech is smoother than oil. Is that not Potiphar's wife? But in the end, she is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps follow the path to Sheol. She does not ponder the path of life. Her ways wander, and she does not know it. Verse 8, keep your way far from her, and do not go near the door of her house. You remember Sesame Street? You know, the guy, he'd run. Far! Near! Far near. I always think of that whenever I read this passage. I think to myself, oh yeah, this is the idea. Like, keep to a path far from her. Don't go near to the door of her house or his house. Verse 9, lest you give your honor to others, your years to the merciless, lest strangers take their fill of your strength and labors go to the house of a foreigner. And at the end of your life, you groan when your flesh and your body are consumed. You think about this text. You read what's in this text, and you're like, this is like reading the story of somebody's life today. You watch their life completely and totally get decimated and unravel because of sexual sin in their life. I mean, they come to an absolute ruin. In verse 14, I am at the brink of utter ruin in the assembled congregation. The ripple, the devastating effects of this. The advice in verse 15, drink water from your own cistern, flowing water from your own well, should your springs be scattered abroad. These are all sort of ways of talking about the sexual relationship. Let them be for yourself alone, not for strangers. Let your fountain be blessed. Rejoice in the wife of your youth, a loving deer, a graceful doe. Let her breasts fill you at all times with delight. Be intoxicated always in her love. Why should you be intoxicated, my son, with a forbidden woman and embrace the foreigner or the bosom of an adulteress? That's chapter 5. Chapter 6, he has more things. Chapter 7, he has even more on this as well. How the seductive speech that happens. Chapter 7, for example, in verse 4, say to wisdom, you're my sister. This is what you need to do to guard yourself against the sexual sin. Say to wisdom, you're my sister. Call in, say, your intimate friend. Because wisdom and insight, verse 5, will keep you from the forbidden woman, from the adulteress with her smooth words. And then he tells this sort of a little account of verse 6. At the window of my house, I have looked through my lattice, and I've seen among the simple, I have perceived among the youths a young man lacking sense, passing along the street near her corner, taking the road to her house. Do not go near her house. Do not go near. But he's going. In the twilight, in the evening, at the time of night, of darkness. Notice everything's done in the dark. And behold, the woman meets him, dressed as a prostitute, wily of heart. She's loud and wayward. Her feet do not stay at home. Now in the street, now in the market, at every corner she lies in wait. She seizes him and kisses him. And with bold face she says to him, I had to offer sacrifices. Today I've paid my vows, so now I have come out to meet you. I've spread my couch with coverings, colored linens from Egyptian linen. I've perfumed my bed with myrrh, aloes, and cinnamon. Come, let us take our fill of love till morning. Let us delight ourselves with love. For my husband's gone. He's on a long trip. He's taken a bag of money with him. And with much seductive speech, she persuades him with her smooth talk, compels him, and all at once he follows her. As an ox goes to the slaughter, or as a stag is caught fast, till an arrow pierces its liver, he does not know that it will cost him his life. The powerful words of Proverbs, Solomon writing to his sons, and his sons, he says this, the same could be said in the other direction if it was writing to his daughters, if there were daughters. The same kind of word and message, right? See, Joseph did what he said here. He encountered this woman of adultery, and he resisted. The Apostle Paul tells us in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 21 and 22, he says, flee youthful passions. Flee. Don't stick around. Don't wait around. Don't flirt with it. Don't toy with it. Don't get as close to the line as you can with it. Don't hang around. Don't wait. Go far from it. Far from it. It is so easy, especially when you're under duress, you're dealing with stress, you're dealing with anxiety, you've been displaced, your world has fallen apart or feels like it's falling apart, to now all of a sudden go into something, whether it's binge eating or whether it's sexual sin, as a way to comfort yourself. When you're in those moments, actually, the wise individual would say, I'm not going to go to this line here. I recognize that I'm in a disposition right now where a lot of stuff's going on in my life. I better stay way far away because I don't have the strength of will and of heart to resist if that moment came. But Joseph shows us the way, doesn't he? Here's a guy who's stuck and can't do anything about it until finally the garment is grabbed and the garment is ripped off of him. I think we're supposed to see a little bit here of maybe a little bit of an allusion to the garment that was his brother's stripped off of him too, aren't we? Father gave him this great coat of many colors. And then his brothers saw it and they hated this garment and they stripped it off of him. Now Joseph is in scene number 2, now in the house of Potiphar. And now he has his garment. His garment is stripped and removed from him. Every time he's stripped of the garment, he's led to the next place. He actually leaves from here. He gets falsely accused. He leaves from here and he has to go to jail. So Joseph is so faithful. He's faithful when he's displaced. He's faithful when he's tempted. And thirdly, he's faithful when he's falsely accused in verses 13 through 20. In verses 13 through 20, she gets to the point where she's like, too much is on the line for her, right? Like, she can't say, well, I tried to seduce the poor guy. She has to say, he tried to seduce me. And as a result of that, her husband gets wind of it, of course, and he ends up in the slammer because of it. And our text mentions nothing about Joseph's defense of his innocence. He probably had no opportunity to do so, nor would it have actually worked. At this point, it would be so easy if you're Joseph to really start to question God. I mean, if you look back at chapter 37, and now 39, you might be looking and saying, my life sucks. I mean, it's horrible. I mean, I went from the favored son in my father's house. My brothers hated me. There was all kinds of dysfunction and things in my family that were so messed up with multiple wives my dad had. Horrible relationships with my brothers. I get taken and mistreated, thrown into a pit, stripped of my cloak, sold to traitors, sent off to Egypt. And now here I am, and for however long I've been serving faithfully Potiphar, but this woman, for however long, has been trying to seduce me, and now she's falsely accused me. And here I am, now I land up in jail. God, what in the world are you doing? Like, where are you in any of this? That's so easy to do that when you're in trials, isn't it? Oh, it's so easy. Trials, suffering, things like this, they can really suck it out of you. But I hope you see in Joseph that even though there's plenty of opportunity actually for Joseph to act that way and behave that way, he doesn't. He doesn't. What does he do? What does he actually do? He actually is faithful. Even when he gets into prison, what does he do when he gets into prison? He again, just like when he went to Potiphar's house, he does the same thing. He grows where he's planted. He's like, okay, here I am, I'm in prison. And now, God, what do you want from me while I'm in prison? He doesn't say those words, but that's what's happening in the text, right? You read that he's thrown into the slammer. Verse 19, as soon as his master heard the words that his wife spoke to him, this is the way your servant treated me, his anger was kindled, and Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. Verse 21, but the Lord was with Joseph and showed him steadfast love and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. You're kind of going like, yeah, but God, where's your favor and all of the other stuff? And the keeper of the prison put Joseph in charge of all the prisoners. You know, Joseph, like, in every situation, seems to rise to the occasion and say, I need to grow where I'm planted, where God's got me. He doesn't seem to give any indication that I need to know or understand all the details. Maybe he had that conversation with God. We're just not told. There's a lot of information we don't know about the young man. But what we do know is that he remained faithful. How about you? When you've got the ups and downs, when things are feeling like they're unraveling or they're unclear or they're clouded or confusing, what do you do? How do you respond? Are you faithful when you feel displaced or things not working right and going well? Or are you faithful or are you unfaithful when tempted in whatever shape and form that is because of all the things that are happening in your life? Joseph holds high for us a vision that you can do that. You can actually remain faithful to God in the midst of the most trying circumstances. I want us to change gears for a moment because we've asked some serious questions about God as we've looked at this text. I want us to talk, we've talked about the faithfulness of Joseph, but I think secondly we need to talk about the faithfulness of God. I mean, how does our text this morning speak of the faithfulness of God? All along, there's no doubt, actually, that God has been faithful to Joseph, even when it's not always evident from just reading the text. If you remember last week especially, we pointed this out. In last week's text in Genesis 13, from the text itself in Genesis 37, there's almost no indication whatsoever that God's involved in that story. How do we know that he is? Well, we know it because of the end of the story. We know it because of what Joseph says in Genesis 45 to his brothers. You did not send me here, God did. You meant it for evil, God meant it for good. God actually has a purpose in what he was doing here. Joseph could see that and understand that. And in today's text, the same is true. I want to give you three ways from this text how God was faithful to Joseph in all of his affliction and the suffering that he was going through. First of all, God was faithful by giving Joseph his presence in all of his troubles. I think we're meant to note this when you look at chapter 39. I want you to notice in verses 2 and 3 how the chapter starts in verse 2. After we're told that he's been sold and he's in Potiphar's house, notice verse 2. The Lord was with Joseph. The Lord was with Joseph. We're supposed to take note of that, no doubt. But notice the very end of the chapter. Verse 23. The Lord was with him. The Lord was with him. Did he ever stop being with Joseph? Not for a moment. He was with him when he was in Potiphar's house. He was with him when all things were going well and he was prospering and Potiphar's house was prospering. He was with him also when he ends up back in the pit, back in prison. He was with him through everything in chapter 37, all the way to the very end here in chapter 39. God's presence was with him. And it's very easy for us in the hard times to really wonder, God, are you actually with us? If you have a pen in your hand, you could do this. You could just write these letters down right beside each other. You maybe have seen this before. Just take a pen and humor me on it if you want. Pretend you're writing. Type it in your phone. These are the letters G-O-D-I-S. So G-O-D-I-S-N-O-W-H-E-R-E. Here it is again. G-O-D-I-S-N-O-W-H-E-R-E. What does it spell? God is nowhere. God is nowhere. Does it though? Does it really spell that? What does it actually spell? It spells that, yes, but what can it also spell? God is now here. You know, so often in our life, I know this is a little kind of cute little thing to do, but so often in our lives when we're going through the Joseph-like stuff, it feels more like God is nowhere, but the reality is God is now here. Right? Like he never left Joseph's side for a moment. What Joseph doesn't have is the advantage of seeing the big picture. So what he has to do in those moments is he has to trust God and remain faithful to God to work out the details. And remember, the Lord never promised you or me that we would not go through significant trials and tragedies and troubles in this life. But he did, in fact, promise us his presence. He did not promise to rescue or deliver you and I from everything, even though in his sovereignty he chooses sometimes to amazingly, miraculously do that. But he doesn't promise it for every person all the time. But he does promise to walk with you through everything that you go. He never promises rescue from, but always promises to walk with you through. And that's Joseph. Somebody might say, well, I don't want any of this, the garbage that Joseph had. I just want it to be better. Friend, you're waiting for heaven. That's what that is. Because it's not promised in this world. The second thing we learn about the faithfulness of God is that God was faithful by giving Joseph his favor in all of his troubles. We see this in chapter 36 when he was in the house of Potiphar. The Lord moved him into a position of favor and blessed the work of his hands. And by doing that also blessed Potiphar's house. It wasn't that Joseph was blessed saying, you know, I got the favor of God on me, now I can buy my big new house and that boat and that jet skis that I wanted. And not that kind of favor. You see, our perverted sort of Christian sort of weird subculture that's out there that I don't even want to call Christian most of the time. That's what they do, right? They turn favor into God into something that it's actually not. Joseph didn't have that kind of favor, but he certainly had favor from God. Why did he have favor? It's hard to get away from the text that he was a man who sought to live faithfully. And I don't want to sort of point out this sort of a cause and effect that if you're faithful, God's going to be favorable to you and he's going to give you stuff. That's not at all what this text teaches, actually. But let me ask you this. If you choose to be like Judah instead of being like Joseph, do you think you're going to have the favor of God? No, you won't. You see, I want God's favor in every season and every situation, don't I? And I don't know what that favor always looks like, but I want his favor and I want his presence in my life in every situation and in every season. And then thirdly, God was faithful by working out his plan in all his troubles. God was working his master plan in Joseph's life. Certainly Joseph is the recipient of the master plan individually, but there's no doubt that when we read in Genesis chapter 45 that God had a larger purpose that he was working, that he was actually bringing Joseph to Egypt, that he was going to put Joseph ultimately in power in Egypt, as we'll see in the weeks to come, because a massive famine is going to hit the land. And Joseph's role and position there was divinely appointed by God. He had to leave his father's house. He had to be thrown into the pit. He had to get sold to the Egyptians. He had to go into Potiphar's first house. He had to have Potiphar's wife try to seduce him and then falsely accuse him to send him into the next pit, the prison. And he had to go from prison all the way out of that to position of power that God had put him there so that people could be spared. That's what God's working here. So as we close this morning, I ask, are you struggling to see what God is up to in your life? Right now, are you facing so many ups and downs that you're having a hard time seeing his hand? Are you looking around at the nation and wondering, God, I don't see you here. I don't know what you're doing and where you're moving and what's going on. This is all a mess. You know, whatever season God has you in right now and whatever season may come, it's really important for us to remain faithful like Joseph. Faithful to God as he's faithful to you, because he's going to bring about his plan. It's a matter of trust. In a moment, we're going to sing the song, "But Firm Foundation." He won't. He won't fail, right? I've still got joy in chaos, the song says. I've got peace that makes no sense, so I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength because I've built my life on Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful in every season. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't fail you. He is with you and he's bringing about his plan. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Lord, help us when we can't see you to be able to have faith that you are there. Help us, Lord, when we can't experience you or maybe feel you, or we're unsure of what's around the corner or what's next. Would you help us, Lord, to remember that, God, you are so faithful, and help us, Lord, to be faithful. Help us, Lord Jesus, to be standing firm in you. We thank you that we can trust you, God, with our lives individually, with this church. We can trust you, Lord, with our community and our neighborhood. We can trust you with this nation. We can trust you with the world, Lord. It's a lot better to trust you than, Lord, to try to do it on our own. Thank you, Lord, that you won't fail, that you're faithful in every season. In Jesus' name, amen.